Oh, Thank you. desert, come away. Come and lean on me again. My beloved, you were calling in the garden, come away. Come away with me again. My beloved, you were calling in the desert, come away. Come away with me again. My beloved, you were calling in the garden, come away. Come away with me again.
Taken from the altar of love, we're in his heart, for You're so good. Jesus, you're so beautiful. We delight in you, God. We delight in you. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Have your way. Have your way right now. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Just stay in that place. Just stay in this place. You know, we're singing, I Know That I Belong. And I just had a sense in my heart that I didn't want to move further than this without praying for people that don't yet know that they belong, that don't yet know they belong to Jesus. You know, God came specifically that those who believe in him would become children of God. And I just want to give an opportunity for anyone in here right now that doesn't, if you don't know that you're a child of God, I'm going to give you an opportunity right now to pray one prayer to become a child of God, to become a son of the King. And so no one else looking around. So everyone can just bow your heads. And I'm just going to ask, if that's you today, if you don't know that you belong to Jesus, if you don't know that you're going to be in heaven one day, if you don't know that you know that you know that you're a child of the King, I'd just like you to raise your hand if you'd like to make a decision today to change that. Just give us, just very gently, no one's looking around, just place your hand in the air. If you're not sure, or if you'd like to make that commitment today, just put your hand in the air. Thank you, Father. Father, we bless that right now in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your presence. Or you might have felt that you were connected to God once, but maybe a friend brought you in today. We're not going to go on about this, but if you felt like you were connected once and now you just feel disconnected, when you pray right now, let's pray with you right now. And so we're just all going to pray together, but we're not. But if that spoke to you about knowing, not knowing that you belong or that you feel distant, just pray this. This, you're not praying it to me. You're not praying it to the staff. You're praying it to God. And so let's just pray together. Say, Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you came and that you died for me, that I could become a child of God. Today I ask you to receive me into your kingdom. I want to become a Christian. I want to have a new beginning from today. Baptize me in your love. Forgive my sin with your blood and set me free that I may become a child of God and everything will be made new from this moment onwards, in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Let's just honor God.
Let's just thank the musos for their worship this morning. New songs, prophetic songs, spontaneous songs. Just give someone a hug or a kiss or a handshake on your way to your seat. And can be seated. Thank you. Good morning, Jubilee. If it's your first time to Jubilee this morning, we just want to make you feel really welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. While we're doing the notices, if we could just get the team to take up the offering, that would be incredible. Thank you. First thing up, we have the Create School this Wednesday at 5:30. And Izzy is speaking on angel armies armed and aimed at Australia. That sounds exciting. And then, of course, we're going to have Harp and Ball straight after that. Then we've got nightlife this Friday at 7 p.m. We are not going to do street ops. We're going to do a social. So we're just going to gather, maybe share testimonies, hang out, have some food. Are we going to meet here? Yeah, we'll still meet here in the cafe at 7. So if you're a young adult, come and hang out. Now, the new service times have been set back. So we're starting a new morning service, but from the 6th of July. That's the wrong slide. Don't look at that. Close your eyes. It's wrong. So that should say July 6th. And we're starting a 9 a.m. service, and then the 10 a.m. service is moving to 11 a.m. And it's all very, very, very exciting. Then we have a mushroom risotto being cooked for us as we speak. Yeah. Yeah, it's $5. How tops is that? And yeah, so we've got our Italian friends next door cooking up some lunch. So if you want to join us, it's going to be $5. Mushroom risotto in the cafe next door. That's going to be a lot of fun. Does anyone have any testimonies? Healing or salvation that they want to share? Just keep them real short. Come on, Simo. I will go. Lorena?
I was going to visit my friend in hospital on Friday. He's got cancer, so he's in and out in the hospital all the time. And I met this guy at the foyer who was in a wheelchair. And so we chat, and I don't get to pray with him then and there. I saw him 3 times in that week, and I didn't get to pray with him any of those times. And then he's meant to be in hospital for another 2-3 weeks. His leg, it was sort of maybe going to be amputated if nothing else happened. It was at 35%, so when he was talking to me, he'd just move it with his hand because he couldn't walk or anything. He'd had an accident at work, and he'd hurt his back, and his leg, it was more than likely going to be amputated. So I go to see him 4 days later on the Monday, and he's been discharged. And I'm like, that's cool. Well, I think nothing else of it, because, you know, he's in hospital. How are you meant to see anybody else again? And I'm in a community event on the Tuesday, which is 5 days later, and he walks up to me and gives me a hug. So he's out of his wheelchair, walking, leaping, praising God.
I've been having some pain in my molar on my left side, and yesterday it's going for at least 2 weeks. And I thought, oh, I'd go to the dentist because it's so pain. When I put it together, it's so painful. And yesterday I decided to come to healing rooms. And before I left the home, I say, Lord, I'm going to healing rooms. And I want to bring something good home. And when Daryl say, is somebody here who to take and the mother on the left side? That's me. That's me. And then he pray, and in five minutes or so, he say, how are you going? I try. Because I cannot put it together, both sides. Well, it's painful. And it's gone. So praise God, praise God, praise God. It's gone.
Hi, this is an announcement just to remind everyone that once a month on a Saturday, the first Saturday of each month, which is next Saturday, Danny and I open our home to married couples, and we come and celebrate together and just rejoice in marriage. We eat, fellowship, and we've been watching a series called Laugh Your Way to a Better Marriage. And we've been laughing the whole time. And, yeah, just bringing more joy to marriages. So if you'd like to join us next Saturday, yeah, please come and see Danny and myself. It's at Bondi Junction, 7 p.m. So come and see us at the end of the service. Thank you.
Hi, guys. Is Jazz or Smash here? No, I can't see him. Ash. We call her Smash because she smashes it. But that's not funny. No, it is funny. I said it. Anyway, back to Jesus. Yeah, this week's been pretty crazy. Well, this month. This year's been crazy. Just like Daryl prophesied, that it's like March. We started marching and it hasn't really stopped. It's been crazy. But okay, so Monday at work, I see a truck driver come in with he had chronic pain in both shoulders for 3 years. He goes, every night I go to bed at 11 o'clock and wake up at 1. I can't go back to sleep because the pain's so intense. He's got it 24-7, 2 hours sleep a night. I'm just like, oh man, I feel your pain. That was the worst part, just sleeping 2 hours. I'm like, that's bad. Then I'm like, let's pray for it. He goes, what is this place? And I go, oh, we do bath salts and it's a healing center. He's like, healing center, you pray for my shoulders, you do my shoulders. And I'm like, okay, let's do your shoulders. And then prayed for his shoulders. He's like, what did you do? What do you do? Who are you? Who are you? And I'm like, I'm Simon. He's like, oh, it's just gone to this shoulder. And I'm like, well, let's get that shoulder. And we got that shoulder. And it's like 1% now. And then I was like, let's go again. And then all the pain left. But then later on, he was talking to Tony at the front for like half an hour. He's going, that guy in there. Who is he? He's something, not because of how he got healed, but because I stopped for him and asked about his world and that kind of thing. And that's what touched me the most. And then on Tuesday, yes, it was good. It was fun. And Tuesday, we went to me, Smash, and Cracker. You guys know her as Becky. Her name's Cracker, okay? Call her Cracker. We went to the uni in New South Wales, and we're just like, just to have fun, really. And the whole thing that was ringing in our head is, I don't know if anyone was here last Sunday night, is it was like, stop looking at the water and start looking at Jesus. It's kind of like there's so many excuses and reasons not to. But the whole time, I was telling myself that, and I was telling the girls, I was like, they're like, I can't do it, I feel like this. It was crazy. But it was epic. Cracker and Smash went into the medical center on campus, which was packed. Like, there was not a spare... No, there was a spare seat next to a girl in crutches, done up foot, when we went in, and they freaked out and ran back out. It was dead quiet. It's like a library, and it's like lines of people. And they went in and prayed for this girl. Like, they went up in front of her and started praying in front of everyone. And I was like, that's epic. That was awesome. I mean, she didn't get healed because she was too scared to test it. But then the girl outside, I saw she had a strapped up wrist, and she had something, blah, blah, itis on her wrist. And it wasn't arthritis, it was some inflamed tendon. I got a video on my phone, and her and a friend were sitting there. I was like, hey, I noticed you got your wrist strapped up. What's going on? And she's like, blah, 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 something, itis. And then I'm like, I told her a few testimonies of the truck driver and that we're Christians, and it's going to sound weird because it always does, okay? But we see people get healed all the time. Can we pray? We got down, started praying for her. Smash was praying for her. She's like, I take authority over this situation. She's just been introduced into this stuff. And she goes, oh, what the heck? She's like, this is effing, what the effing? All this stuff. And it was epic. And she's like, you don't understand. I couldn't do this before. I did this doing judo. I got a championship coming up. I can train tonight. But it was epic. And then from there, I turned around and saw this girl limping, like a big limp, huge limp, like a big limp. And she was like over the other side of forever away. So I ran after her. And I swear she sped up, but we're not going to go into details. But I caught up to her. I'm like, hey,
I noticed you're limping. What's happening? And she's like, I got cerebral palsy. I was born prematurely. And she said, like, she was so meek, and she was just like this gentle girl. And I was like, and I was like, well, can I show you a video of what just happened literally 30 seconds ago over the under this grass that we're looking at? And I showed her the video and all this kind of stuff. She's like, that's awesome and stuff. And I go, can I pray for you? She goes, no. And I'm like, okay, can I hug you? And I just gave her a hug, and she hugged me like this and then sunk into the hug. And then the girls were saying her face was priceless. And then I was like, hang on, I feel like God wants to tell you that you were born right on time. And she's like, it's like almost starts melting and crying in front of me. But I mean, there was many more healings on campus. I haven't got lots of time, but man, stop looking at the water. Anyway.
Come on. Wow, isn't that incredible? If the kids could go through, that would be incredible. And then let's welcome Papa Fini to the pulpit. Before I launch into the word this morning, Ken and Roz, can you guys come up? They're on their way to Europe, to Geneva for the Transform World Conference. Come on, who wants to transform the world? So you guys tell us what you're doing, and we're going to pray for you and just bless you.
Well, we're representing the South Pacific for houses of prayer and 24/7 worship, but our house of prayer is a house of prayer for healthcare, and we're going over there to meet with others who are doing likewise. And, you know, when they take $80 billion out of the budget for healthcare and education, we need to pray. And the Lord spoke to me from Psalm 103 in the Passion Translation, I think it's verse 19, and he says, he will do amazing things in the middle of our mess. So we're really looking to God while we're there to do mighty things. We would like to connect health workers online and do a 24/7 thing that's global. And there are people there from South Africa and also from Wales that we will be relating to. So, yeah, we would value your prayers.
Come on. Can I just add one other thing? We're also visiting some friends who are just also setting up a house of prayer for healthcare in Belgium, in Ghent. And so they also have a church, which is a Spanish-speaking church, for people who come from Spain and from South America. And they've asked us to speak to their church in 2 weeks' time about our work amongst the Karen people on the Thai-Burma border. So I think that's pretty amazing that some Aussies talking about Karen on the Thai-Burma border to a Spanish-speaking church in Belgium.
I don't know if this is going to make any sense in this time or the next time, but I've heard the name Taylor, whether it's a first or I think it's a second name, that God's going to link you to somebody of significant authority in government called Taylor. I don't know if it's in the UK. That's, I could be wrong, but I'm just going to step out there. And so if we get a good testimony, then I've taken a big gap. But we want to stand and bless you.
Father, we just thank you for healthcare. We thank you for the houses of prayer. We thank you for the Burn 24/7 movement. We thank you for increase in worship. We thank you, Father, for transforming the world. And we thank you for the power of the cross. One day in history that changed the world. And we thank you, Father, that they go with our blessing and with our love and with our honor. And we thank you even that they're being honored in terms of representing the Australia and the Pacific Rim. We thank you for what they're doing, their initiatives, their passion for prayer, their passion for healthcare, their passion to rewrite the curriculum for the doctors in New South Wales and Australia. We thank you, Father, you're doing things. And you're on the move in healthcare worldwide. And we just release our blessing to them. And we thank you that they'll come back with stories, with just stories of the glory in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. 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 Well, when you ask the question, is there a doctor in the house? Well, there is. And there's Dr. Jesus and there's Dr. Ken. And I think there are a few others as well. Shabba. So when you turn to the book of Isaiah with me, there are a couple more testimonies while you're turning there. We had some people saved this week. Last Sunday evening, I met someone who got saved at the end of the evening service. You know, we don't always do altar calls. This morning, I know there was an altar call in the worship. We don't do it as a religious thing every week. But a lady got saved, first-time visitor, got saved on Sunday night. And then on Wednesday, during the healing rooms, there was a visitor there who'd been brought by a friend. And she was in dire straits, needed all sorts of prayer for all sorts of things. And God just got a hold of her, and she was so powerfully touched. I remember when I was praying for her, she said, I'm so embarrassed. If you're here, I don't know if you're here, I'm not trying to embarrass you even more, because no one knows who you are. But she said, I'm crying, and you're a man. And her culture prevented her from ever doing that. She said, please don't tell anyone that I cried. And I'm like, no, well, can you see all the tissue boxes in the church? We do it all the time. Yeah, that's quite normal. Jesus wept, we weep. When God moves and he touches our hearts, well, that's a very normal response. And so God's healing you. These are tears of healing. And I just so honored the Lord that this week people are getting saved. And it's part of my message this morning is the message of salvation, the message of the nursery that Candace Simmons spoke about. She saw a nursery over Jubilee. And a nursery is to do with babies. A nursery has to do with newborn. The nursery has to do with faith for salvation. And so I believe 2014 is a year of faith for salvations, new believers. I love transfer growth. I love people coming to Jubilee who want to receive more of God, more of the Holy Spirit, more, or they've transferred from another city or another country. There's many reasons why God's adding people to us. But the first prize is always people who've never known God, who've never tasted of the goodness of God. And that's what blessed me this week. And there were some radical healings too. You know, we hear about words of knowledge, and often we think, well, wonder where that person was, wonder what happened to them. I met two people this week who responded to words of knowledge by Daryl in a service, and they said, this man, I don't know who he is, he called out a lump on the left breast, and it was me. And I always know when Daryl gets going on the breasts, it's always like, ah, do you have to give that word about breasts? But what do you do? Like, God's not Victorian about these things. And if that's the condition and he gets the word, you got to go for it. And we get a little bit awkward about it, but God's not awkward about it, and we shouldn't be awkward about it. Amen. But all of a sudden, I was meeting someone and said, that was me, and I snuck forward, and you know, God touched me and gave me faith, and I've been cured. She actually had surgery. She didn't get healed in the prayer. But God got her number. And then on Wednesday, there was a woman who, Daryl had a word of knowledge about the knee, the left knee. And she like, well, that's me. She got up. I don't know who she is. I don't think she's a member of our church, because she was going for an operation and need a new cartilage, and a whole big story. And she was like, she was shocked. She was in tears because she was healed instantly in the healing rooms. Come on. Come on. So faith is spelled R-I-S-K. And we've got no guarantees, you know. And because we don't heal people, we also don't take a hit when they don't get healed. And I enjoyed Simon's testimony about the fact that Smash, or one of those girls, were running after someone, and they pray in front of everybody, and then nothing happens. I honor that. I love that story. I love that, because it's like, come on, let's thank the Lord. Because if we only tell the stories of people that get healed, but we don't tell the stories of those who took a risk and they thought they heard and they went out for it, then it's just like we only celebrate people who have first-class degrees. Well, we want to celebrate everybody. We want to celebrate risk. We want to celebrate faith. Amen. The disciples came to Jesus and said, we couldn't cast the demon out. Why not? And then he tried to disciple them in the whole process of healing. And we were in that journey. All of us are disciples learning on a learning journey. And I love the fun in the house of God that helps us go on the journey, not feel embarrassed about the journey. not feel embarrassed about grazing our knees, not feeling embarrassed about having a go at something. I think I'm hearing from God this name or that name, Taylor, whatever it is. We've got to have a go. Come on. If you don't have a go, you'll never experience the rush of seeing God use you and feeling God using you for His kingdom. So, have you found Isaiah 54? We're in transition, and I just want to minister a little bit into that this morning. It says, verse 1 to 3, I'm reading in the NIV. Sing, O barren woman, you who never bore a child, burst into song, shout for joy, you who were never in labor, because more are the children of the desolate woman than of her who has a husband, says the Lord. If you're singing and no one's looking or someone is looking, it doesn't matter, because you're prophesying fruitfulness. Singing is prophesying fruitfulness, particularly if you're singing when you don't feel like singing. Enlarge the place of your tents. Stretch your tent curtains wide. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen your stakes, for you will spread out to the right and to the left. Your descendants will dispossess nations and settle in their desolate cities. The New Living Translation says, enlarge your house, build an addition, spread out your home, and spare no expense. I like that. I like the spare no expense part. That's a Living Translation. New English Bible says, enlarge the limits of your home, spread wide the curtains of your tent, let out its ropes to the full, and drive the pigs home. So what God's saying to us is that we need to lift off the limits of our thinking. This season of enlargement, the season of transition, the season of change, and if you're here this morning, you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll get there. But we're in a season of change as a congregation, as a body at Jubilee. And it applies to all of us, whether you're part of this church or not, because all of us go through seasons of change, and we have to have a framework for what happens when there's change. How do we respond to God? How do we respond to each other? Well, how do we frame up change? We all want change, but if we do the same things and expect a different result, then we're just being silly. If we want change, we have to change. We have to change to bring about change. So the first thing we have to do is look at what has God said. Because if God doesn't say come, then don't get out the boat. Amen. Stay in the boat. If God hasn't said come, then you're silly going out the boat. You just need to get out with armbands on or a boogie board. No, if God, you only get out the boat when God says come. When Jesus says walk on the water, you can walk on the water. You can do things you can't do in the natural. So there are four words that I want to home in on this morning, and it's enlarge, stretch, lengthen, strengthen. Say enlarge. Enlarge. Stretch. Lengthen, strengthen. Those are the four words that we're going to look at and delve into them and suck the marrow out of every word, because that's what God's saying to us. He's talking to us about a season of change. And change is fun. Change is not serious. Change is not intimidating. Change is not something that we need to be afraid of, because when God does something, He first announces it, and then He gives the capacity and the faith for us to fulfill it. And then we look back in another time, we look back and we're saying, man, how did God come through for us? But right now we're on this side saying God's calling us forward. And then next year we're going to look back and think, wow, we got here. And all those who had faith are going to say, wow, I told you God would do it. And you're going to say, yeah, I told you so. And do you hear what I'm saying? So we're in that phase right now of the looking and watching and waiting on God and speaking about the things of God. First thing I want to say is that in terms of buildings, if you aren't aware that this building's for sale, we don't feel to buy it, and so we're looking for a larger building in the city, probably a warehouse, probably a non-religious building that we can make a big noise in. Amen. A happy noise. We can put our sound meter away for good. We'll just put it to pasture. Why are buildings important? Just the first thing, why are buildings important? Does God love buildings? I don't think so. He said He doesn't dwell in a building. He doesn't love buildings per se. I'm sure He loves architecture, because I love architecture. How many of you enjoy architecture? God loves attractive buildings. I think He's into attractive buildings. I don't think He enjoys buildings that are unattractive. I think that God is attractive God. He created attractive things in nature. Everything about God is creative. And so He, you know, when you see something that's an eyesore, well, that God isn't into that. And God's got mansions for us in heaven. Mansions. He didn't say, I got caves for you in heaven. Special cave for you. Dave, your cave. No, he's got a mansion for you, Dave. And it's paid for. So it's a mansion. It's something extravagant, something more than what we need. That's what God's got for us in heaven. And when you look at the use of buildings in the scriptures, you look at, like, when the day of Pentecost came, it says they're all gathered in a room, an upper room. It doesn't say what kind of room it was or how big it was, but we know there were 120 people. And it's important they were in the room. They needed to be there to get what God was going to pour out. It wasn't like they were just under a tree, although God could move under a tree, I'm sure. But in this instance, they were in an upper room. Someone owned the room. They were paying rent. Or maybe they owned the room as a church. I have no idea. It doesn't explain it. So we don't jump to assumptions. But they were in a room. They'd been there for some time. They'd been there for many, many days and weeks, fasting, waiting on God, waiting for God to do what he said he was going to do. They were there in the room. To get what God was going to do, you had to be in the room. That's why I turn up at church every week, because I don't know what God's going to do. I want to be in the room when God moves. I don't be in the room. I don't be outside the room under a tree when God's moving in the room, because then I'll be like, oh, he should have been there. God moved. Oh, shucks, I was under the tree. It's no point. So God doesn't love buildings, but he moves in buildings. He uses them to house people. He uses them to gather people. He uses them to help people to feel connected, to help them to feel loved, to help them to feel like, man, I made this building look nice. We're going to, because I mean, the warehouses we've looked at are very ordinary looking. You walk into this massive space, it's 1,000 square meters. I'm like, it just looks like a warehouse. Pallets lying everywhere, forklift, grease on the floor, cobwebs really. I don't know. I'm not asked. But, you know, it's going to need a lot of work to make it something habitable, something that we can feel comfortable and proud of. But that's neither here nor there, because God doesn't love the building. He loves the people that we're going to reach that are going to come into that building. Come on. Come on. So I want to make sure that's the focus, because even the money that we've invested so far in this place, and I'm sorry for if you feel a little bit upset about, you know, you've put thousands in and you've taken up offerings and we've improved this building for someone else. Isn't that part of the character of God too? That we invest money and we expect a return. That's what certainly my initial response was. We've spent over $700,000 fixing up this building, making it nice for someone else. Why would God do that? Well, quite clearly he does. You reap where you haven't sown. Bible says that. You reap. So someone else is going to reap where we sown. But if it's the kingdom, if it's another congregation that gets to enjoy this place because of what we've invested, haven't we still invested in their lives? Haven't we invested in their future? Amen. Isn't that a worthwhile investment? So no one's getting ripped off. You can't get ripped off if you're given to God. You can't get ripped off if you've invested and said, God, I'm giving you this money. I'm investing in this building, and we're here, and we wish we were here. We maybe have liked to be here for longer or whatever, but it seems like that season has run out, and we need to move on. So what does it take? What is this first word is stretch. Sorry. What was the first word? Enlarge. When a woman falls pregnant and she starts to enlarge, it's uncomfortable for her, I'm told. I've been told 6 times. But not for a second does she resent it. Not for a second does she think, man, this sucks, you know? This is terrible. I look ugly, I waddle, I'm going to get stretch marks. No, that's part of the beauty of the transforming work of being pregnant is the stretching, the enlargement, the growth, the wonder of something new that's been conceived and is now growing, and you can't wait to see it. But while you're in that transition phase, it looks awkward. You can't do certain things. You can't do certain exercises, or you can't wear certain clothes because it would look weird. What is that? Well, that's enlargement. But who resents it? No one does, because there's a birth, there's a promise, there's a birth coming, there's a transition coming where we're going to get to see what's inside there. And that's what the phase we're in. We're in the phase of being stretched, enlarged. So what has God said? He spoke to us supernaturally. He spoke to us through the prophets, Brian Simmons. He spoke to us through Patricia King, and he spoke to us through Izzy, our own prophet in the house, our fearless leader. Amen. So when God speaks, You don't move because it's a good idea. You don't move because someone kicks you out. You don't move because someone, you just get fed up with the neighbor, although it's tempting. You don't move for those reasons. You move because God says. And if God says move, you say, when shall we move? And if God says move, then he provides the next step. And while it isn't immediately obvious to us as to where that place is, and we're looking every week, we're scouring the countryside to find it, all we know is that God has said move. And so we're preparing ourselves for the next 6 months to avail ourselves to look like a church on the move. Can you receive that? When God wanted to move Abraham, and when God wanted to show him what his future was, he said to him, Abraham, you're struggling to receive, because of your long-term barrenness, you're struggling to receive a word about birth and conception and inheritance. So God took Abraham outside. How many of you have been outside in the country, in a desert, in the mountains, where there's not a natural light as you can see anywhere? All you can see is the canopy of stars. How many of you have been outside like that? How beautiful is that? And it's like there's not more stars, but you're going to see more because there's no distraction. There's nothing taking away your eyesight and your eye line from the glory of the canopy of stars. Well, that's what God did with Abraham. And he was in the desert and there weren't any natural lights around. And he said, if you can see the stars, if you can see it, you can have it. So shall your offspring be. So I'm asking you today to dream with me, to imagine with me. I want you to take your imagination out of this building and put your imagination somewhere else. I want you to see enlarged facilities. I want you to see a facility for kids' ministries, for administration, for I-61, for nightlife, for healing rooms, for every part of our ministry, that God's got room for us to grow, that God's got room for us to dance, that God's got room for us to celebrate, God's got room for us to have tribal warfare if we want to. Come on. That God's got room for us, and I just want you to see it. I want you to think about it. I want you to ponder it in your heart. I want you to meditate. Don't meditate on what we have. Meditate on where we're going. See it in your mind's eye. Picture it. Can you picture it with me? Can you see it? It's not this. Because if you can see it, you can have it. Jeremiah 1:11 says, the word of the Lord came to me. What do you see, Jeremiah? I see the branch of an almond tree, I replied. The Lord said to me, you have seen correctly, for I'm watching to see that my word is fulfilled. So God wants us to see what he can see for us, an inner picture. If you have an inner picture, you can have an outer experience. First the inner experience, first the inner picture, first the inner conception, when the Holy Spirit overshadows Mary and she conceives, and then 9 months later there's a birth. So right now the Holy Spirit's overshadowing us. God's lifting the limits of our thinking. Number two, the second word is stretch. This is the part where we allow the Holy Spirit to take us out of our comfort zones. And if he's taking me out of my comfort zone, he's going to take you out of your comfort zone. So get out of it. All right, get out of it with me. Get out of the boat. How do we stretch ourselves? What is a practical way? I'm going to give you a couple of ways that we are being stretched. Number one, stretched in prayer. I've faced a couple of things this week. I was threatened with legal action to do with our noise and different things, and I've spoken to my barrister, and I'm going to have this letter of da-da-da. What did I do with that? Well, I asked the elders to pray with me, but I prayed. See, there's no point in being overwhelmed by a situation that you can't pray about. When you go to the secret place of prayer and worship, I just pray louder, I pray longer, I get out my guitar, I say, well, I need to find a place where I can laugh about this. I got to get to a place where I can actually laugh about it, because if I'm going to be intimidated, if I'm going to be pushed down, if I'm going to be bullied by the spiritual enemy, because the neighbor's not the enemy. You're all aware of that. The neighbors, no people are the enemy. People aren't the enemy. But the enemy, the real enemy, wants to keep us quiet. He wants to keep us mousy. He wants to keep us bowed down. He wants to keep our faith low. He wants to keep our vision low. God wants to lift our vision up. He's the lifter of our heads. He wants to lift our voices. He wants us to lift, clap our hands. He wants us to shout. He wants to get excited. He wants us to have vision and faith. So we're going to move in the opposite spirit. So when the enemy wants to push you down, God's going to stretch our 10 curtains wide. He's going to stretch our faith. And all the place we can do is find it in the place of prayer. Find it in the place of praying in tongues, singing new songs, stretching. So stretch with me. Give yourself to increased prayer over these next 6 months. Say, Lord, I hadn't even thought about that. But Pray. Pray for us. Pray for us as leaders. Pray for the building. Pray for Alan. Pray for Peter, the guys that are helping us look for buildings. Pray for the for us that we'll find the money and find the time and find the right location with parking. Say parking. Come on. Just pray for these things, because when we see it, we're going to say, we prayed for that. This is exactly what we prayed for. This is the thing I was picturing. We're going to talk amongst ourselves and say, man, you know, funny, that's this street name, because I got that name. In prayer, I got that name. You're going to see things, answers to prayer like that. That's what's going to happen. So that's the first stretching. Ephesians 6:18 says, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions. I think that covers everything. All occasions. With all kinds of prayers. I think that covers most kind of prayer. Pray in tongues, petitionary prayer, thanksgiving prayer, prophetic prayer, pray on your knees, pray while you're walking, prayer sitting, prayer driving, with your eyes open. All prayer is good. Every kind of prayer is good. What's the best kind of prayer? Happy prayer is good. Number, what kind of prayer? The Lord's Prayer, you know? Well, you can leave out Hail Marys probably, but just every other prayer would be good. Really. It's not like we have a kind of prayer that's most effective. Happy prayers are good. Faith-filled prayers are good. Prayers that come out with an exclamation mark and are not a question mark. Prayers that come out of the heart of God that say, God's got good things for us, so I'm trusting you for good things because you're a good God. He doesn't give his sons a scorpion if they ask him for fish. He doesn't give us weird stuff. If we ask him for good things, he's going to give us good things. So those kind of prayers are good prayers. But every kind of prayer, you pray your short prayers, long prayers, prayers in tongues, prayer, you know, shaking your head, nodding your head, walking up and down. All those prayers are good. Don't compare your prayers to someone else's prayers. Well, I don't pray like them. Well, let them pray like they want to pray. You pray like you want to pray. Don't compare your prayers, but just stretch your prayers. Stretch them. Stretch your prayer times. Fast, if you can. That got very quiet. It's a whole new concept. He says, with this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me. I love the fact that Paul had no problem with saying, pray for me. I'm saying, pray for me. Pray for Izzy. Pray for the team. Pray for your home group leader. Pray for the musicians. Pray for the volunteers. Just pray. Just pray for people. I found myself this morning just praying for all my leadership friends around Australia. I thought, man, I don't often pray for them. I wanted to text them, but I didn't have all their numbers. But I thought, guys in Byron Bay and guys in the north and Darwin and guys in Adelaide and Melbourne, all our friends that we know are meeting this morning around the country. I just prayed for them. I thought, this is a good feeling. I should do it more often. Stretch me in prayer, Lord. Where else are we going to be stretched? Number two, in our volunteering. As we go to two morning services, as opposed to one morning service, well, they're going to be stretched. We're going to need more musicians, more people on the door, more people taking up offerings, more people preaching, more people leading worship. What are we going to need? Well, we're going to be stretched. And if we anticipate that when we get stretched, we won't say, oh, I'm being stretched. This is stretching. This sucks. Man, I've got to get up earlier. I've got to get to there earlier. Well, no, we'll say, no, we prepared you because you're pregnant. And when you're pregnant, you get stretched. So be happy, you pregnant thing you. Stop whinging about volunteering. No, get happy, because it's going to involve more volunteers. And you might be saying, well, I'm not stretched at all. I just come to children's church on Sundays. I do nothing. Well, then volunteer then, for crying out loud. We don't want to be stretched and you not getting stretched with us. Why should you just sit there comfortably and not volunteer? Get away with you. We're having a meeting on the 10th. Is it Tuesday night? The 10th. To just talk about changes in the house. What will the two services involve? So if you're not yet involved and you'd like to get involved, come on the 10th. Tuesday night, the 10th. It's Tuesday week. And just say, here I am. What can I do? We can find something for you. Don't worry. We'll find something. the third area of stretching is financial stretching. And this is an area that obviously it touches us all, because we're all going to be involved in spending money and preparing ourselves for the fit out, which will cost probably more than $500,000 just to fit out the place. I'm not talking about increased rentals. But God's up for it. And he always pays for what he plans for. If he's planned for it, he has the resources for it. So I know that over the next 3 months, we'll be taking up offerings. We're not going to do it today or next week. But we're preparing you to get behind us and raise that kind of money. It's a large sum of money. God's spoken to me personally about what I need to do, and it involves a motorcycle. Well, what do you do if you haven't got, you know, thousands in the bank? Well, then you take something that you have that's valuable, and you sacrifice it. You put it on the altar, and God's got more of those things. Amen. Down the road, I'll still know how to ride by the time I've sacrificed it and got another one. But it's just it's in transition. Leadership always has to pay a price, and then the church will pay a price. And when we make a sacrifice, it's a sacrifice that we can pay, that we can afford. And of course, it's like awkward, and you think, oh, that was my inheritance and my mum and whatever. Well, no, my mum is in heaven. Amen. She doesn't care at all. This is about heaven's future. This is about investing in people that are going to get saved. Everyone who gets saved in our new building, it'll have an investment of my time and my money and my life in it. And that's the future I'm looking forward to. That's the inheritance that we're looking for. Come on. So over the next few weeks, probably 3 months before we actually have found a building and we can actually say, well, this is the amount. We can't give you an amount until we have a building and we have a design and we have some builders that can say to us, this is the actual amount that we need to raise. I'm giving you just figures that I feel in my heart that might be inaccurate, but they'll be somewhere close to that. And so I'm preparing us, because a wise steward, it says, when you plan to build a tower, sit down and work out what it'll cost you. That's what Jesus said. If you plan to build a tower, sit down, stop, pause, work out what it's going to cost you. Can you afford it? And so that's what we're doing right now. We're sitting down with you. We're saying, what's this going to cost us? Well, it's going to cost us a lot. More than what we have right now. And so I'm expecting that as the church grows over the next 6 months, that we're going to have millionaires join us. We're going to have people that own properties and lands. People might, maybe one of them has a warehouse, saying, a warehouse? Oh, I got several of those. No problem at all. We don't know yet. That person might be here this morning. But that's what I'm anticipating, is that once you make the decision, then all sorts of resources and heavenly initiatives come to bear. While you hesitate, there's no momentum. Once you decide, there's momentum. So to me, the momentum happened weeks ago when, as an eldership, we decided this is the way we're going to go. That's when the momentum started. And now we're just working out the details and saying, Lord, okay, help us find the specifics. Does that make sense? So, lengthen is number 3. Take longer spiritual steps. Lengthen your stride in prayer and faith and worship. Take longer prayer times, longer time of soaking. Linger with the Lord. Just lengthen your capacity with God. Say, God, I've got a capacity. I love my capacity, but I want to increase my capacity. Say, increase my capacity. That's what I'm praying. Number 4, strengthen. While we're being stretched and enlarged, it's not a time to neglect what we already have. And I thought the thing of strengthening, driving the stakes in deeper, is that what God already has done in our church, the Create School, our Sunday services, kids ministry, worship, young adults, all the things that we have going for us, healing rooms, God wants to strengthen that. Actually, on the move, it's a time to dig deeper relationships with people. It's a time to connect even stronger and saying, man, what's happening in your life? What's happening in your life? Man, let me pray for you even more. It's the love connection. Everything about this move is about love. Not love of buildings, but love of people. And we don't want to love the lost if we can't love those that are right next to us right now. And so God's saying to us today, strengthen your love walk. Strengthen the relationships you already have, because the strength of the relationships that we already have will increase the capacity for us to add new people. Did we all get that? The strength of the nets determines the catch of the fish. And the net comprises relationships. How good are your relationships? Are your relationships really superficial? Or are they getting deeper? The decision's up to us. I can have very superficial relationships with people if I keep them at an arm's distance. If I keep them at an arm's distance, then they'll never really know who I am. But if I strengthen those relationships, it's by going a little bit deeper. Not blah, just a little bit deeper each time. Just a little bit deeper each time. That they know and I know, we're crossing over the Jordan together. We're going to go to the other side. We're not sure how far it is. We're not even sure where the other side is. But Jesus said there's an other side. And we're going to the other side because Jesus said. Come on. Strengthen your strengths. I write down here. Strengthen the strengths we have. We're not looking to create a new movement, a new way of doing church. We're going to do it the same because God's given us a DNA, something that we're passionate about, a way of doing church, a way of running ministries, a way of doing healing and prophecy that we love. Those things are DNA. We're not going to change that. So God wants us to strengthen our strengths. Amen. We're talking about strengthen your weaknesses. No, I'm going to get people around me who have my weaknesses, who have strengths where I'm weak. I don't want to strengthen and work on my weaknesses. I want to work on my strengths. Amen. I want my strengths to get stronger. And God will provide people in the body that have strengths where I'm weak. And lastly, I want us to sing. The scripture began this morning, sing. Sing, sing. Sing, O barren woman. What does singing do? Singing attracts heaven. Singing attracts angels. Singing attracts glory. Singing opens our heart to heavenly realities. Singing opens us up to healing. Singing opens us up to the prophetic. Singing opens us up to the glory realm where God does mysterious and wondrous things. And that's why God says sing. The fruitfulness, the power of fruitfulness, the power that's released in the barren woman when she begins to sing is that she's saying, God, I'm not staying where I am. I'm going to embrace new. I'm going to embrace change. And this message for us is about a body moving forward, but it's also about you moving forward. It's not just the body. If we move forward, we all move forward together. So this is about enlarging your faith for your gift, for where you are right now. It's enlarging your home group. It's enlarging your influence in terms of ministries further afield. It's enlarging your capacity to touch your neighbor, to touch your colleagues at work. It's enlarging your capacity to believe God. Even the testimonies we've had this morning, they're all enlarging us. They're saying, you can do this. Try this at home. Do this, it works. So when you sing, no one can sing for you. Come on. Don't tell me, Finn, you haven't heard me sing. I want to hear you sing. This is not The Voice. God turns around every time you sing. He loves to hear your voice. He's not judging you. He's not comparing you to some other virtuoso. God turns around when you sing. He sends help from the heavens when you sing. He loves your voice. He loves who you are. And I want to finish off with Song of Songs, chapter 2. Don't put it up on the screen because I'm going to read this from the Passion Translation. Just because it's better. I'm going to read from chapter 2, verse 10. It says, "Arise, my dearest. Hurry, my darling." He's talking to us. This is the bridegroom speaking to the bride. Okay? "Come along with me. I have come as you have asked, to draw you to my heart and lead you out. For now is the time, my beautiful one. The season has now changed." Say, "The season has now changed." What that means is it's changed. It's like, oops, we can't have that one back again. It's just changed. I know that today is the first day of winter. And doesn't feel like winter, does it? But nevertheless, it really is. Whether you feel like it or not, it actually is winter. And I'm very happy for us to skip right across winter and touch spring as soon as possible. But in the spirit, the season has changed. We've moved on. We've enlarged. God's already enlarged us. God's already shifted us. We already feel uncomfortable. We already feel like, oh, everything's changing in our prayer and the way we see things, the way we do things, the way we plan our future has changed. Not is changing, it has changed. The season has now changed. The bondage of your barren winter has ended and the season of hiding is over and gone. The rains have soaked the earth and left it bright with blossoming flowers. The season for pruning the vines has arrived. It's a season of singing. The season of singing and pruning are the same word, all right? So the season of singing also involves a season of pruning. Cutting off things that don't bear fruit, getting rid of stuff that doesn't work in your life, that hasn't borne fruit, things that you thought were important that aren't important. It's part of the season of singing. It's not just singing la la, la 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 la, it's also pruning. Chop, 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 chop. I hear the cooing of doves in our land, filling the air with songs. What does the cooing of doves have to do? The cooing of doves is only heard during harvest. It's the harvesting season. That's when the doves are cooing. So we're hearing the sound of the harvest. We're hearing the sound of the newborn. We're hearing the sound of the fruit of the children of the barren woman. We're hearing that sound. Can you hear the sound? Can you hear the sound in the spirit? Can you hear it? Open your spiritual ears. It's not a natural sound. It's a spiritual sound. It's like you see in the spirit. You can see that building that we're pregnant with. You can see. You can hear in the spirit the sound of the newborn crying. You can hear the sound of the cooing of the doves. You can hear the sound of the harvest coming to Jesus. That's what we can hear in the spirit. Can you... to awaken you and guide you forth. Can you not discern this new day of destiny breaking forth around you? The early signs of my purposes and plans are bursting forth. Say bursting forth. That's what it feels like. And budding vines of new life are now blooming everywhere. The fragrance of their flowers whispers, there is change in the air. There's change in the air. I love that. There's change in the air. Who's whispering that? The flowers are whispering that. I love this beautiful poetry. Arise, my love, my beautiful companion, and run with me to the higher place. For now is the time to arise and come away with me, for you are my dove, hidden in the split open rock. It was I who took you and hid you up high in the secret stairway of the sky. Let me see your radiant face and hear your sweet voice. How beautiful your eyes of worship, and I love the sound of your voice in prayer. You see, because our voice is sweet and our face is lovely to Jesus. He loves our worship. He loves Jubilee. He loves all the churches. I'm not just saying that we're extra special, but he loves our sound. He loves our worship. I felt this morning when he was singing some of those really beautiful, intricate kind of melodies that heaven really pays attention to those. They got channels of glory on them that she's crafted in the place of intimacy. And that angels are attracted to that. And this is what God's saying is, your face is sweet and your voice is lovely. He loves our face. That's why he says he's the lifter of our heads. He doesn't want us to walk in shame. He doesn't want to walk us in embarrassment. He doesn't want us to walk with any reproach on us, because there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And even if you're new to Jubilee, you think, well, I've just got you. Now you're moving. That's not very nice. I quite like this place. It isn't about a building. It's about a transition in our hearts. It's about enlarging our capacity. It's about enlarging our love. It's about giving us more of Him. And where we end up is almost immaterial. It's not immaterial, but it's not important. It's us that's important. And it's the people that we're going to meet that are important. And we're going to say, how are you? We prayed for you before we met you. We didn't know you, but now we know you. And we're going to love you. Come on. That's what it's about. The Lord says to us this morning, I love the sound of your voice in prayer. You must catch the troubling foxes, that sly little foxes which hinder our relationship. You can work out what that is. For they raid our budding vineyard of love to ruin what I've planted within you. Will you catch them and remove them for me? We will do it together. Father, I just thank you for the hope, and I thank you for the future that you've crafted for us. We thank you for our imagination that you've dreamt up this time, 2014. You dreamt it before we are living in it. You saw it before it happened. You knew that the buildings would change hands. You knew that there'd be an awkward neighbor. You knew that there'd be trouble in the street. You knew that there would be blessings in this place. And we thank you, Lord, for just the incredible amount of love and glory and healing that there's been in this place. And we thank you, Father, what we've had here is going to be multiplied hundreds of fold in our new place. If we think it's been good here, Lord, then it's going to be so much better when we move. And so we thank you for that inner picture of transforming glory. We thank you for the finance. We thank you for enlarging us in our inner being. with regard to believing you for more, for increase. I pray even now, Lord, for job promotions, for people who are unemployed to get work, for people to get new contracts even this week, Lord, that we'll see immediate signs of the of budding flowers in bloom in this season as you've as we change seasons. And we thank you for that now in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Yeah, we're going to do this from time to time. Nicola is a chef, and he's offered to, with a few of his crew, to cook us food. And so today, you're invited. I believe he's made enough to invite the whole church. So you won't get a risotto at $5 anywhere else other than Jubilee's Milk and Honey Cafe. Okay, so we're going to worship and then... No.
I just thought we'd respond and just...
Let's have the team, worship team up. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
We arise to your voice, O Lord. We arise to your voice, O God. You said, our voice is lovely. We
Just sign their kids out. We're going to have a ministry time now, and if the ministry team could just come out, and if you have words of knowledge, you can launch straight out. And the rest of us, if you don't want ministry, you can filter through to the risotto station. And please linger, hang out with people, meet some new friends. We'd love to get to know you a bit more. Nothing like food to make friends over. Any words, guys?